Welcome back, everybody. Let's finish up our discussion of the one sample t-test. I hope you've noticed how close the t-test is to the z-test. They're practically identical. The critical region for the z-test, of course, is based on z-values, and that z-distribution is normally distributed. So this is one place where they do differ, because the critical region for the t-test, of course, is based on the t-distribution. It's still a distribution of sample means, but that distribution of sample means is not normally distributed, and in fact, it changes its shape based on the amount of data that we have. So it changes its shape based on the degrees of freedom. The more people we measure, the more degrees of freedom we have, and the more normal that distribution becomes. Of course, with the z-test, we compute a z-statistic, and we use the population standard deviation, sigma, to define the standard error of the mean. Ultimately, these are the formulas that we use. For the t-test, the test statistic, of course, is t, and we have to estimate the standard error of the mean. The formula that we use to estimate the standard error of the mean is based on the sample standard deviation. So when we don't have the population standard deviation, we use the sample standard deviation as an estimate. That's the only difference, really, the only fundamental difference between the z-test and the t-test. There is one other thing that I want to discuss with you. Once we start estimating things like standard error, it sometimes makes things just a little bit more complicated. And for the t-test to be accurate, for us to be able to trust the results, there are certain assumptions that need to be met. Let's talk about those assumptions next. I mentioned to you previously that we're going to learn three different t-tests. We already learned the one sample t-test. We're going to learn an independent samples t-test. We're going to learn a related samples t-test. So we're going to be talking about t-tests quite a bit. All of those t-tests need to have various assumptions in place for us to be able to trust the results. Let's talk about the first assumption. The first assumption is independence of observations. This is primarily a research design issue, and what I mean by that is this assumption can be satisfied pretty easily by how we decide to collect our data. The bottom line is that no observation should influence another. That's what I mean by independence of observations. So for example, if I were to ask you how much you weigh because I was going to collect data on that subject, when I ask you that question, your answer can't be influenced by anybody else. So it makes sense when I collect that data, I'll collect it in private. Because think about this, in private, if you give me that information anonymously, you're much more likely to give me the true answer. But if I were to put you on the spot and ask you that question when in a group of many other people, then it's possible you might change your answer to conform with the rest of the group. If they're lighter than you are, for example, you might say that you're lighter than you really are. In other words, in that situation, your answer, your data, would be influenced by other observations. That's a problem. The second assumption I call the normality assumption. We need to assume that the population of data that we're dealing with is normally distributed. If we're collecting data from a sample, how do we know if that population has data that's normally distributed? Well, to some extent, we can estimate that. If we look at our sample data and we see that it's normally distributed, it's relatively safe to assume that the population data is normally distributed. Remember, if our data was randomly selected, it should represent the population. In other words, it should have the same types of characteristics as the population. Many people feel that that's a safe assumption. If your sample data is normally distributed, it probably means the population data is normally distributed. However, here's the good news. Regardless of the shape of that distribution, these t-tests are robust to violations of normality when the sample size is reasonably large. And what I mean by reasonably large in this situation is a sample size of 30 or greater. As long as the sample size is 30 or greater, the t-test will perform reasonably well regardless of the shape of the distribution. And that's at least partially because of central limit theorem. When we create that distribution of sample means, even if that underlying population is not normally distributed, our distribution of sample means will be normally distributed as long as the sample size is 30 or greater. That's good news. I hope you enjoyed this discussion of the one sample t-test. The next time we get together, we'll learn some new inferential tests. I'll see you in that next video. In the meantime, be safe.